I was finally home for a weekend visit. It was strange to be home again, but good. I'd been gone long enough for home to reclaim an old newness. The furniture was different. My bedroom was now a guest room currently occupied by my now strangely older little sister, Anna, and a whole gaggle of her high school friends. Rather than a homecoming, it felt more like an intrusion on Anna's now busy social life. Mom and I hid out in the kitchen so to avoid any potential embarrassment we might haphazardly inflict. The guest room door opened and music and laughter rose with the swing of the door and hushed again as it closed. Anna tore through the kitchen with just a nod to acknowledge me, then turned to a grocery store bag and said to Mom, "Les pommes et fromage? Remember? I thought it would be ready by now." She stormed off. Mom said nothing, for all that I could tell she wanted to say. Her eyes narrowed in a way that betrayed what boiled beneath. Mom and Anna were alike in their assertive natures, so when they clashed, neither would yield. "What was that about?" I asked, hoping to defuse this somehow. "She's so wound up about entertaining her guests." Mom began to unpack the grocery bag, Gala apples, a few blocks of different cheeses, and some crackers labeled entertainment crackers. "You know she's taking French now. It's great, really, and she has a gift for it, but for those of us not up on our French, it's getting annoying. I know she's stressed out about her little party, so I'll let that demanding tone slide for now, but we're going to have a talk about it later." I realize now that sideways nod my sister had given me earlier was a complaint, because all my talking in here with Mom was messing up her appetizer schedule. I continued chopping potatoes for the roast, and Mom began slicing the apples, and there was only the sound of knives against the cutting boards. "You know, those apples look a lot like these potatoes when they're sliced up like that," I said. I don't think she would see the difference without the skins. Mom considered this, smiled, and without a word, she took my cutting board and I took hers. Mom nearly laughed once these potatoes and cheeses were plated with their entertainment crackers. Anna rushed in and took the plate in a thankless huff. Mom and I looked at each other, knowing we couldn't take them back now. "They're still palms," I said. "Really? Palms de terre. What's that mean?" "Roughly, dirt apples." We laughed and waited. Each second of suspense killed us. It took longer than we expected. As we waited, I felt something like guilt or regret as I imagined those poor girls in the guest room trying to choke down these potato slices, not wanting to tell my sister there was something off about these apples. Perhaps trying at first to pretend like they liked them, then watching as Anna finally samples one and questions it and asks around and wonders why no one told her or if it's just her. And gradually Anna will squeeze it out of her mean girl lieutenants that it's not just her, that these palms are Mao. Anna stomped back into the kitchen to tell Mom the apples were bad, like a maitre d' scolding the sous chef. Mom hee-hawed. This was the punchline she'd been waiting for. "No," she said when she got a breath, "you're the bad apple." "Mal Palm," I said, and I immediately regretted opening my mouth as Anna's eyes cut at me and I realized too late that I had incriminated myself in this bad apple fiasco. "Mal pomme de terre," said Mom, really enjoying herself now. "Bad potato?" Anna growled. She was indignant. "Dirt apple is a more accurate translation," Mom added, really, really enjoying herself now. I again felt the anxiety that surrounds their clash of wills. "It's just a little prank. Take it easy," I told her. This only affirmed to my sister that it was I that was truly to blame. "Do you realize how embarrassing it will be to go back in there and tell my friends that they just ate raw potatoes because you thought it would be funny?" Now I had to defend myself. I couldn't cede the moral high ground that justified the prank in the first place. "Oh, it's harmless," I said, making light of her near-fatal embarrassment. "Surely your friends have heard of a prank. And really, you had it coming after the way you barked at Mom about your palms et fromage. You can slice an apple, right?" I was at the top of my game, ready for anything this scary smart sister of mine might throw, until she let out a long, diffusive, seemingly French sigh, and without heat, the coup de grace, "I wish you hadn't come back." She turned and moseyed like a lonesome sheriff back to her guests. Damn, she's good. She's so grown up. "Yes, I'm afraid so," said Mom. "Well, now I'm the bad dirt apple. I had hoped this would cue Mom to assure me that I was not the bad apple, but she just weighed the possibility with a shrug of her shoulders. Well, you know what they say about apples and trees. You're the tree, Mom, I countered. Mom didn't dispute this. There's Joseph, I said, hearing the sound of our middle brother's truck in the driveway. The one good apple, I thought. If he'd been here, none of this would have happened. He can take some of the blame for his absence, at least. I began dutifully chopping apples. I sliced the rest of the cheeses and opened a new sleeve of entertainment crackers. I drafted Joseph the golden apple to deliver these hors d'oeuvres because the cut of Anna's victorious eyes would have been too much for me. I made a quick trip to the store and searched for anything French. I was looking to buy some sort of dignified apology off the shelf, but there wasn't anything like that in the limited inventory of our small town grocery. So I settled instead for some sparkling grape juice from Altus and some real rind for the rest of us. Some coffee for the French press we never used, some overpriced chocolates, Dijon mustard and baguettes for finger sandwiches, and I hope that this might say sorry.